something on the seat next to you.
Exactly.
this is what happens in the game. You tell him he doesn't cut the ball in front, block you goal. He's going to talk about you in the right place.
Thank you. Karen told me that her dad had a few favourite songs that he really loved. This opening song was definitely one of his favourites. She also mentioned that Jock thought the girls in the film clip were a bit of all right, so makes it a perfect song to begin today's farewell. Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Bairnsdale City Oval, a place where Jock has spent much of the past 30-plus years, and a most fitting venue to celebrate his life on this beautiful autumn day. This service for Jock is a chance for our community to commemorate his significant contributions and achievements and reflect on the spirit of a man who made an indelible mark in all of our lives. We're gathered together this afternoon in memory of John Edward Rodwell, affectionately known as Jock, Johnny, or just Rodwell. With the spirit of friendship that you each bring, this farewell for Jock is going to be made even more special, and I know that his family really do appreciate your love and your support. Well, through the connections that Jock made during his life, especially his time here in East Gippsland, he became a mate to so many. He was a mentor and a friend and a bloody good bloke, and today is a chance to celebrate his life and say thank you for all that he has done. Jock was laid to rest in Echuca last Friday with a small private burial as per his wishes, and those who knew Jock well would agree that today's gathering is in stark contrast to the private person he was. While we take this time to acknowledge the public figure that Jock became, we also focus on the man himself, the loved husband, father, grandfather and friend. Jock valued sincerity and honesty. He had a straightforward nature. He enjoyed the simple things in life, and underneath the public persona lay a heart warm with so much love for his family. To Merrin, Sharon and Ben, we extend our love and sympathy. Jock was a devoted husband, father and pop, and losing him has been a very sad time for you all. To Jock's extended family, including Graham and Veronica, Wayne and June and Alan, our thoughts are also with you and your families. To everyone here this afternoon, you were all an important part of Jock's life, and I'm sure if he could, he would thank you all for the love and the friendships that have been shared. As we take this time to remember him in our own special way, may it be a warm reminder of how much Jock has meant to so many. Jock lived an amazing life. Born and raised in Echuca, Jock's childhood was full of mischief, and he learned from a very young age resilience and determination to make the best he could out of life. Jock's working life began as a plumber. However, after discovering a natural gift for identifying and resolving skeletal and muscle issues, what followed was a 34-year career in remedial massage, in which he both excelled and loved. Jock was widely admired and respected for his work in remedial massage, earning him the nickname the Guru. Jock's techniques to treat and prevent pain, often an injury, often included a lot of pain, which I'm sure there are many here that can agree. I'm one of them. But he knew what he was doing, and he had clients from all over Australia and beyond. Jock worked with the Essendon and St Kilda Football Club, and I'm sure he would have been over the moon that they beat the Pies last night. He worked with Shane Warne, Tamsin Lewis, and while with the Saints in a pre-season in the UK, Jock met and worked with Sebastian Coe and the UK Sprint Team. Jock's path also crossed with Dean Wallace, who became like a son, the son that Jock never had. They formed a very special relationship, and they have remained close all of Jock's life. Then for around 30 plus years, Jock has been a welcome addition here at the Bairnsdale Footy Club, and he made an unbelievable amount of friends along the way. Sharon had so many memories and stories of her dad. He was selfless, caring, fun, cheeky, and so devoted to his family and to his work. Jock would move heaven and earth for anyone in need, and he was so generous in giving his time. Most importantly, family was always his number one priority. Merrin, Sharon and Ben were his world, and everything he did was for them. Merrin was by Jock's side through all of life's adventures, and she supported and encouraged him with his passion of helping others. Sharon and her dad enjoyed a very special and close bond. She was known as Chickadees, and in more recent times she was the boss. And his grandson Ben was Jock's little partner in crime. His pop taught him so many life lessons and a lot of mischievous things along the way. Well, everyone here would know that Jock's dry sense of humour was a very big part of his personality, and he loved keeping you on his toes with his quick wit and his banter. A mentor to many, Jock was someone who was always there to support, encourage and teach, and there will be many here this afternoon who have experienced his guiding hand. These qualities touched the lives of so many in ways that he contributed to his family, his friends, his workplace and in our community. A few recent messages of support on social media I thought summed Jock up so well. I'll miss coming to pick you up on Thursday nights for training and you getting up me for being 3 minutes late. The time he dedicated to the Bairnsdale Footy Club was second to none. Jock always had the quickest wit. We will miss his sarcasm and dry humour. He was just a really good fella. Jock was a mountain to us, and his compassion, friendship and love will never be lost. A community and advocate through and through. Thank you for your unwavering service, Jock. It didn't have to be about footy. Jock was just great company and a wonderful man, and it was a privilege and a pleasure to know him. What a man. He started putting my body back together when I was only 27. 30 years later, he said, "Alfie, I can't fix your hip. You need a new one." He gave his heart and soul to the Redlegs. We got him involved and to training and match days right to the end, where he would continue to still have his darts and have a crack at you with his dry sense of humour. No more beef schnitzels in the canteen, as we only cooked one for you, Jock. Jock, you took care of me and my family for over 34 years. Harden up, princess, or that doesn't hurt will forever be etched in my mind. And finally, my favourite comment, and one that many of us here can relate to, as I mentioned, Jock was the master of making you cry and laugh on the massage table at the same time. An unbelievably kind man who always wanted the best for his clients, the footy club and its players. To begin our tributes for this afternoon, I'm going to invite Jock's very proud brother, Wayne Ford, who is going to give us a bit of a snapshot in history into Jock's early life and what's brought us here today. Thank you, Wayne.
Well, thank you very much. Well, hi everybody, I'm Wayne and I'm Jock's youngest brother. As you just been told, there was a private burial up in Echuca, and I just wanted to let you know that it was as big a shock to us as it was to anybody when his final wish was to be taken home and buried close to his dear sister, which wasn't much of a deal, except that was about 500 k's away. And it just proved that even after his passing, he could be a pain in the arse. I'd like to give you a brief insight into the early days of Jock's life, and it would shape the man that you knew. It makes for some grim reading. It's not easy. It wasn't an easy life. But it just highlights how good it was at the merit of what he was able to achieve in his life. John, and it was John, was born post-war. Days that were quite different as we know now. He grew up in a stable and loving relationship, lived in the family home that his father, Jack, aka John, aka Dad, built. He enjoyed a simple life, and especially with his bestie, big sister Roz. But at 9 years old, his whole life was turned upside down when his guiding light and Dad had passed away. And he was left in a situation where he was left with a widowed mum, four siblings, very little money, and no of the support services that we know today. Life was a challenge for him, especially as we got through his schooling. The times were tough, and he would find at times that we'd be going to school in clothes that had been repaired and patched and repaired again. There was often times when he would be walking around in shoes stuffed with newspaper, because the soles had worn out and there was no money for the repairs. There was also an occasion where he was forced to wear a pair of his mum's shoes to school, because he had none of his own. And I've only just learned about that one. Only the bare necessities were available to them. There were no silver spoons in any mouth in his household. And just to make it a little more difficult, there were extended periods where his mother was hospitalised. His younger siblings were fostered out. Pressure was borne upon the family for all the children to be fostered. But with the grit that we know he had and self-reliance, he stayed home with his sister Roz. So after some debate, he attended the Echuca Technical School, where he took to his chosen trade of plumbing. And it's around this time that we were introduced to Jock. There was some confusion about the exact time and who gave him this nickname. But Jock it was, and Jock it would always be. And very, very few people outside his immediate family ever knew him as anything but. And I would think there were many people who never knew his Christian name. When he left school, he attained his apprenticeship, did his time, and became a registered plumber. Then it was probably the most pivotal time of his life, when he met, courted, and married the love of his life, Merrin. Over time, she was able to knock the rough edges off him as he morphed into the man you know today. But, and there is a but, there's always a but with Jock. He was no angel. He experienced, well, he was well acquainted with the strap and cane at school. He also experienced some tough love at home, and it was brutal. He also got to know the workings of the laws enforcement, especially as he thought a bit of biffo on a Saturday night was just a part of social interaction. And his less endearing habits of the incessant teasing of the younger brothers, and the worst of the lot of his habit of walking up behind somebody and sticking his bloody finger in your ear hole. It was gross. And he also had a compulsion to destroy everybody's Christmas pudding to find the coins within it. And I think this is one battle he may have won, because I was able to place the final coins of this into his coffin grave. Jock has certainly left an indelible impression on many of us here today. But then that could be just the elbow and thumbprints. But that's another story for us to be told. But above all, he rose, he forged his own path, he became a gentle man. And he's a man that I'm proud to call my brother. Thank you.
Thanks, Wayne.
First of all, to Roddy's wife, Merrin, daughter, Sharon, and grandson, Ben, our condolences, especially Sharon, the amazing job what you've done over the last period of time up and down the highway, making sure that the love and the care is there has been amazing to see, and something you should be really proud of. And I know Jock just loved you Our community has lost a special man who always put his hand up to help others. Often in small communities, you need that person that you can rely on to stick the hand up, and Jock was always there. With everyone gathered around here today to pay respect, he has helped you in no doubt in some way or form, whether it be on the table or just saying hello at the footy club. He loved the Bairnsdale Football Club. Whether for me, coaching another footy club, no matter what club you were or at, Roddy would always offer to help, keeping players on the park, giving them the opportunity to participate and have fun amongst each other. It didn't matter what club you were involved in, he treated you all the same, and he was just proud to help out and see others have a crack. That was just Roddy. In boxing, another one of his loves, he always went above and beyond just to help making appointments, keeping the guys fit, healthy, and let them participate. And he just, no matter what he did, he gave his all. We were one of the beneficiaries of that over a long period of time. The common question would be, how are we getting there? What time are we leaving? And who's picking me up? We're always asked. He's one for timelines. If you weren't there, catch up for a coffee. He'd be standing around on the nature strip, walking up and down, leaning on the blue car. It's just how he was. And then he'd be sort of looking at his watch, are you coming or what? Sometimes you cancel, and he would say, no worries, mate, no drama. Catch up next time. Obviously, a couple of the guys, the Wills here today, Morgan, the ones that have, and Blake and Max are fighting this weekend, and they're not here today. They're home trying to make weight for tomorrow's event. But he was a massive part of our team. He'd always try and would go somewhere, and he'd be just the first one there to help out. He loved it. And like any team, when you lose one of your team members, it's bloody hard to replace, and he's always going to be remembered amongst our crew for just what he gave to us and the one-liners and atmosphere he created. Lastly, I'll miss the coffees, the support, whether it be going to his house, catching up at a cafe, or in later days going up to the nursing home and chilling out and having a coffee with him. He was a great mentor, a set of ears to listen, and give you some great guidance over the journey. So proud to call him a mate, and he'll certainly be remembered. Thank you.
I'm just going to let you know that my speech is probably going to be a bit rough. I did work with John Rodwell for 15 years. So he rubbed off on me. I'll get it together. Just letting you all know that this speech may contain coarse language and may offend some listeners. For those of you who don't know me, for roughly 15 years, I was Kerry from Rodwell's. I called John Rodwell, and he called me the Dragon, amongst various other names. I first met Rodwell and Mez when I applied for a job at their home in Swan Reach. I met Mez, and we just hit it off straight away. We sat down, and Mez said, I hope you didn't have any trouble finding us. I said I drove out yesterday to make sure I knew where you were and I wouldn't be late. I think that sealed the deal right there. Many a time, I had the privilege of watching them dance in the kitchen out there. He acted tough, but Mez brought out his soft side. Rodwell and Mez moved into town and we worked in Grant Street, then around to Nicholson Street. I think that's where he had the most fun. He did have a way with words. Get in there and get your gear off. You're late. He'd say to someone, what's wrong with you? They'd say, I've got a sore back. And excuse me, he'd say, well, if you lost that fat gut, you'd be a lot better off. On the odd occasion, he may ask,
how are you doing? And they'd say, good. And he'd say, well, what are you doing here then? One of his others, what do I owe you for that? Nothing, he'd say. You have to get past the dragon out the front and good luck with that. He was a funny man. You never knew what was going to come out of his mouth or what he'd do next. Then there was the time some poor unsuspecting fool wore his muddy boots on Rodwell's carpet. Rodwell was waiting in the doorway. He said to him, take your boots off now, and proceeded to pick them up, walk to the front gate, and threw them into the middle of the road in the rain. This resulted in me having to leave a chair out the front with a sign on it telling everyone to take the muddy boots, shoes or thongs off before coming in. As with any massage business, let's say you would get some odours of the stinky kind wafting out of his room. Rodwell used lemon essence spray. He'd come out spraying that stuff everywhere, including on me. I'd tell him, piss off, you prick. He'd laugh and just keep going. I had a man who came in one day and he was being quite aggressive about an appointment. John Rodwell could hear everything from his room and he listened. He liked to know what was going on. Rodwell come out and told him, you can fuck off now and never come back. He then pointed at me and he said, you don't ever have to take shit from anyone. He said, no one except me. I knew then he was fond of me. He'd also come out and we'd play a game of charades. He'd say to me, I need you to contact that bloke, that tall one, or that dark-haired one, or that woman with red hair, or whatever, because I need to talk to him. And the stupid thing was, I knew who he was talking about. I never had a sick day, and for that I'm very proud. Even if I was half dead, I went into that office. So this one day I went in with hardly any voice, could barely whisper. He came charging out of his room and he said, what's wrong with you? I whispered, I think I have a bit of laryngitis. He said, thank God for that, I thought I'd gone deaf. He would stick his finger in a freshly poured glass of water I was drinking. He would lift his leg and fart beside my desk. He would put out of order on the toilet when it wasn't. He would write fuck off on a note and put it in his chocky tin to stop a chocky thief. That was when we worked in another building. He loved doing that one. It kept him smiling for days. He loved all the homemade Christmas cakes he would get at Christmas, and there were a few. Never shared any. I got engaged, and as soon as Mez found out, they started putting money away as a gift for Phil and I to give us a wedding present. Phil and I got married on the weekend of the EGFL Grand Final. Ben Starr was in that Grand Final, and I was in trouble. He told everyone, what sort of person gets married on a Grand Final weekend? I had ruined his plans. On the actual day of our wedding, he did show up, Mez by his side. I was up getting ready with the other girls, and my phone started ringing. It was Rodwell. I thought, oh, isn't that sweet? I answered and he said, what are you doing? I said, I'm getting ready. He said, you're late, get moving. He was a prick, but a damn good one to me. He never stopped. He was not a flashy man. Give him a coffee, cigarettes and Mentos with the occasional KFC and he was happy. And that's why I think this poem explains Rodwell to a T. You have to put up with me. I read of a dragon who stood to speak at the funeral of a friend. She referred to the dates on his headstone from the beginning to the end. She noted that first came the date of birth and spoke the following date with tears. But she said what mattered most of all was the dash between those years. for that dash represents all the time that they spent alive on Earth, and now only those who love them know what that little line is worth. For it matters not how much we own, the cars, the house, the cash. What matters is how we live and love, and how we spend our dash. And I know that Rodwell, Mez, Sharon and Ben are mighty proud of his dash.
Kerry, thank you. The tributes have been awesome so far, and I know today is really about celebrating Jock's life, and he would have loved that we're having a laugh, and he would have loved the swearing, I'm sure. So just to break up the speaking, Laurie and Alfie, of course, are great mates of Jock's, and Laurel's tribute today is not a written tribute. She's going to sing for us. This is a great chance to just sit and enjoy Laurel's song while you reflect on your own memories of Jock.
Thanks, Gina, and of course, When you say it's my tribute, it's actually probably Sharon's tribute. Sharon contacted us and she said, would you be able to sing this favourite song? That it's actually called Old Dogs, Children and Watermelon Wine. And evidently, when she was younger, or maybe even older as well, they used to sit there, her and her dad, and sing this song. So this is you guys.
Watermelon wine.
Thanks, Laurel. That was beautiful. Now we have Daryl Smith to share a few things with us today. Thanks, Daryl.
Hear me? Okay, Sharon asked me to say a few words about my friend John. I think she called us Batman and Robin, but you make your own interpretations. Back in 1990, which seemed a long time ago, when I first moved to this area as a young green doctor with a young family, the head trainer at the time, Kenny Williams, approached me. He knew I had an interest in football and sort of invited me to come across the football club to see if I could help out and see what I thought. And as you know, I'm still here. But there on the first day, I met this rough diamond called John Rodwell. Over the years that followed, we became very close friends on and off the football club, even to the point that he trusted me to be the family doctor. But I couldn't get him off those bloody cigarettes. He was smoking right to the day before he died, I think. Once a week we would meet for coffee. And as you've heard from previous speakers, you're not allowed to be late with John. If you're more than a few minutes late, you'd be tapping on the watch, wondering where you've got to. The order would never change. Skinny latte, double shot, extra hot in a mug. That was the order for years and years. We met every week. We'd then spend the next half an hour solving all the problems of the world, and after half an hour we'd go our separate ways and do it all again next week. I don't think we solved any problems, but we had a good time talking about it. So that's sort of my interaction at a personal level with John. I'd like to also spend the rest of my talk talking about John's time at the football club from my point of view. I know Dave Preston's going to put his point of view shortly. But I think we all know that John was sort of Ben-style football netball club through and through. During the season, he'd ring me at least two or three times a night, usually at 9 o'clock at night, which annoyed the crap out of my wife. She'd see the phone ring and I'd say, "Who's on?" I'd say, "Oh, it's John." "I don't answer it." I'd say, "Well, it's John, I better answer it." So I'd talk to him. And he'd just want to talk about the football. He'd want to do a post-mortem on the week before. He'd want to talk about the next game. He wanted to talk about the injuries, who needs scans, who I need to see. It was all about the football club. So such was his dedication to the club. In addition to that, I think I could say without fear of a lie that the trainer's room was John's room. That was John's domain. No one was allowed to go in there and treat his players without his permission and without his supervision, which did annoy a lot of people over the years. We had quite a few physios, OT, chiropractors and osteopaths coming off of their services. Jody and myself used to have a little bit of a book to see how long they last, because after a couple of weeks they just couldn't work with John. And John couldn't work with them, and John let them know. So they were out the door pretty quick. It was sort of either John's way or the highway. And I think some people misinterpret it. It just really showed the dedication John had to his players. They were his players and he looked after them, and it had to be his way. There are some people outside the football club who probably don't really know much better. I used to call him the witch doctor at Ben-style Football Club. But nothing could be further from the truth. From my point of view, John would ring me up and say, "Oh, this guy's done their knee, I think they've done their cruciate." And there's not many times that John's diagnosis was wrong. Over the years and all the experience, he could usually sum players up pretty well. So he knew his stuff, so he was no witch doctor. I've also seen him perform some minor miracles. I've seen players come in at half time at the football hobbling, you'd almost think their legs being chopped off. John would attend to them. As you've heard from previous speakers, there'd usually be pain involved. Then they would get up and they'd play best on ground the second half. The name David Preston comes to mind. We also had some interesting interactions over the years on a footy club, as you can probably imagine. Just to cite a few examples, Sharon said if I could just throw in a few examples. On a few occasions, we've had papers come off with an obviously dislocated shoulder. John would just sit them in the chair, have a chat to them, get them to relax, give them a little cuddle, and then he'd give me the nod and I'd pull the shoulder until they knew the shoulder was back in place. And we did that with a few other injuries, which you'd probably need to get away with nowadays. Then there'll be other examples. Many a time we'd be spending, it'd be 6 o'clock in the middle of winter, some little dingy changing room, and I'd have to stitch up a footballer. There'd be no more help around, everybody else would have nicked off. But there'd be John, and he'd be holding the torch while I was stitching. But the problem with John is he got easily distracted. So someone would come in and talk to John, and next 2 hours she'd be in dark again trying to stitch somebody up because the light's gone. So we'd have terse words a couple of times to get him to concentrate. There are other instances, we've had players come off and we'd sort of sit there arguing over the players, and I'd say, soft tissue, your problem, John. He'd say, no, it's a broken bone, it's your problem, and I don't know what the players thought of us. So there are other examples which I won't bore you with today, but thanks for the memories, John, and rest in peace.
Well done, Smithy. I think that's the most I've ever heard you speak in one time. Well, Jock, you've picked the day, haven't you? You've picked an amazing day out on the hallowed turf. I'm sure you'd love knowing we're out here. All I need is just a little smear of the fried balsam under the nose, because Jock loved putting stuff like fried balsam on. And then his tiger balm. Tiger balm was like the one ingredient that Jock could not live his life without. He used to buy it in cases from the pharmacy, and I think there'll still be scattered amongst these buildings jars of tiger balm, and I think I was speaking to Sharon and she was saying that she's still tracking down the tiger balm. Just on behalf of the footy club and football and netball club, would really like to thank Maren and Sharon, the family, for the opportunity for us to do the memorial here, which I think is really special. Great things are done by a series of small things by regular people that are brought together. And it's very true, I mean, when we think of the fabric of what is the Bairnsdale Football Netball Club over many years, you know, we have done some great things, but it's all about just people turning up and doing their thing. And nothing could be truer than what Jock did over the years at his footy club for well over 35 years. And we have many fantastic people, and if we just sort of, I know a lot of people here today, you know, would have had the great honour of playing on the ground and playing through those periods in the last 30 odd years. And if we reflect on the many great sort of, you know, teammates we played with, the great support staff, the fantastic supporters, the great administrators, and that is the fabric of this football club. And it's not just about the past and the people who've been through the club, but also the present day. And you know, it really, those great things are only achieved by the people who come through the club. But if you can imagine game day, and game day here, and it's fantastic we're situated out here, I thought we'd be inside, but you can imagine game day here. And many games, and this guy's played about 500 of them here. But it was really comforting as a player and a coach, because you'd look around and you'd be here, and looking back, and just over there in the corner you'd see Ronnie Schrader, you know, standing there with Charlie Macca, Bernie, fag hanging out of his mouth. Further along the fence over there you'd have Kay, Bev, Dottie, Merle with their banners. In the kitchen, you know, we had Pam, Robin, Mel Neal, Bev George, Laurel, Jackie, man in the kitchen. And then you turn over to the bench, and it was a different bench. It was the bench like that one there. And you look across, and there was Chooker George. He was always there. I think he was there for 30 years, just holding the board. And Chook would be there. There'd be a coach next to him, Stewie, in the latter years. And then just over next to Chooker would be Westy, on his knees, getting ready to run messages out. He never ran one message out to me that I can remember, because he knows if I ever thought he was coming close to me, I'd tell him to piss off, because he'd try and drag me off. And so he never came once I told him that. But then in the other corner, on the other side, there was Dr. Darrell. There was Jock, and there was Juddy. And to this day, that was the sort of
feel you got. You had the past players over here, and it's very special to think back on that. But over there in the, Jock would be there. Player would limp off, walk over, go through. Jock say, get on here. So they'd come across, and they'd get on there. And then after about 3 or 4 minutes, you'd see Chooker George, he'd sort of wander over, as Chooker does, sort of like this and go, what do you reckon, Jock? And it was either, yeah, you can have him back in 5, or nah, he's done. And that was it. He went away. There's no questions asked. There's no more information. You just accepted that. Because we always accepted what Jock said, or Dr. Darrell. And he was always right. Thursday nights, you'd be inside, you'd be coach, and you'd be hanging on the word, waiting for Jock to walk out to give you the summary, who's available. Said, yeah, he's right, he's not right. Oh, nah, he's no good. Yep, he's right. You know what, to this day, I don't think he ever got a call wrong. He was amazing. How he could just, his skills were that he could just determine what was going to play out. And that's a real skill in itself and a talent. And of that, you know, he should have been very proud of that skill, because not many people had it. On a personal level, I sort of considered Jock a great friend. We never talked a lot, all right? We just, you know, there'd be words here and words there, and I got to know him really well back in 94 when I started coaching, heading out to Swanee. Merrin's out there, take the boys out there. And then he started spending a lot more time at the footy club. But he was a real special talent, and he was just one of those people among that special group doing great things, and that we can be thankful for. But I'll finish with one last thing. I think Jock's longevity can really just be put down to one thing: the advent of the netball club. Thank God for the bloody netball club. That's all I've got to say. Bit less of rubbing down Gags' hairy ass, massaging Dion's man boobs, or trying to fix Hoppy's long-suffering calves. They were never going to get fixed. Bit less of putting Brody's shoulders back in after he careened through 15 players in a pack. But a little bit more of petite thigh massages, maybe for Brooke. You know, tweaking the ankle of maybe Lauren. And just as I was sitting there, Kayleen said, I've never seen a man who's been able to unclip a bra as well as John did. So thank you for all the netballers in the room, because it is the Bairnsdale Football Netball Club. And just on behalf of the club, we can be thankful for Jock's contribution, his spirit, his skills, and that amazing contribution he made and will always have at this football club and netball club ongoing. Thanks. And I'll pass over to Bills.
I'd just like to start by saying how honoured I actually am to be asked to stand up today and talk on behalf of the footy club and me personally. I met Jock probably about 25 years ago, just as a young 17-year-old kid running around on the footy oval here. Didn't know a lot about him at the time, but everyone spoke really highly of him and said, look, go and see him. He's really good at what he does, but you'll get a little bit of pain. So one night I'm out here training around, sore calf, hobble off the track, and there he was, standing at the top of the rooms, leaning over the bar, cigarette in the mouth, frown on his face. What have you done now? Oh, I've got a bit of a tight calf, it's a little bit sore. Well, in you go, let's have a look. So anyone that knows Jock knows he knows exactly where to find the sore spot. So I hop in there, lay down on the table. Now, tell me a bit of the story about what you've done. Well, before I could even start, there was a thumb right in the back of my calf. Well, I nearly hit the roof. Grabbed hold of the table for the rest of the session. He was trying to work on it and just gritted my teeth, hoping that I was never going to have to get back on that table again. But it worked, and his methods worked, and he's got me through to where I am today. Later on in time, as time went on, we got to know each other a little bit better, and I found out that if you bought him a cup of coffee before you went to see him, he was always a little bit nicer. So went along the lines of, things are going to hurt, you'll still be sore, but it'll be okay, I'll make it a bit easier for you. So I figured that out pretty quick. Whenever I thought I was going to retire, it was time to pull the boots up, always got this tap on the shoulder. Don't even think about it. I'll get you through. Just one more year. Just one more year. That's all we'll do. And we did. Right up until last year. Both my wife and I had to see Jock during the year, and he wasn't always at the footy club at that stage, so made the phone call, popped over, picked him up from home. We come over to the rooms. We had to take a detour though. We had to make sure we went past the clinic because we had to see if Smithy was working or not, as I'm sure he was going to hear about it if he wasn't at his clinic. So in we come, 20 minutes later, something like that. We both walk out feeling pretty good about ourselves. He's done his job. I had to go back to work, so I said to Loz, can you drop Jock home? Now, she knew what street he lived in, but didn't know the number of the house or anything. So they drove around for 20 minutes, up and down a little court in Eastwood, before chuckling to himself, having the time of his life, before he finally confessed which house it was that they actually lived at. That was just Jock's sense of humour coming through. Over the time, we celebrated a lot of wins, analysed a lot of losses together. But I'm sure he's helped a lot of people out there get through, netballers and footballers both together, major minor injuries. And some of his famous lines that you would have heard was, what have you done now? What do you want me to do? How are we going to fix it? Or, I don't know if anyone else has been out there told that a 5 cent piece will fix the side of your knee. If you strap it in there, it'll take the pain away. Then it went on to salt tablets and magnesium tablets. Make sure you take them, it'll stop you cramping. So right from the start of the year, here you are, shoveling tablets in your mouth, not knowing if it's going to work or not. And then his latest craze was, go and see Cara, get orthotics and get heel raises. They'll fix all your issues. So I don't know how many footballers out there at the moment have had to go over there, get some heel raises, not knowing whether they're going to work or not. But I think the most of all I'm going to miss now is just the random phone calls that we used to get. Well, he's at home. You'd answer the phone, there'd be a bit of muttering. Sometimes there'd be nobody in the other end of the phone. Then you might get, oh, this bloody phone, then beep, and it'd hang up. Then he'd ring you back 10 minutes later and go, what did you just ring me for? I go, I didn't ring you, you rang me. So hang the phone up again. Another phone call. By the time we got to the third or fourth phone call, we finally figured out what the problem was, what we were supposed to do, and how we could fix it. But I really loved his no-fuss approach to life, his sense of humour and his stories. But most of all, I think I just miss his friendship and the occasional chats we used to have. So rest in peace, Jock.
Sharon is going to have the last word today in our tributes.
That's if Sharon can get through the last of the tributes. Today I have to try, in a short period of time, to sum up the life of Dad. I'm not sure exactly how I put into words such a life, but I'll give it a go. And I'll do my best to keep it together as I do. Dad drank his last skinny latte, extra hot with 2 sugars, and don't forget to burn the arse out of the milk on Saturday the 2nd of March. It was a beautiful sunny day, and the magnificent part of it was we were outside, coffee in hand, just as we had been every day for many years. Whether it be together or chatting on the phone, it was our daily ritual. We were with our family, and it's a beautiful, sweet memory of Dad that I will always cherish. We lost Dad a couple of days later in the early hours of the 5th, and he snuck out on us just as he always had, quietly, with no one even knowing he had gone. Dad always had a habit of disappearing during family dinners and functions, and he was usually found tucked away in a corner with a cheeky fag in hand. In true Dad style, he did it his way, sneaking off to heaven just as he always had, saying nothing and with little or no bother to anyone around him. You all know him as the football trainer, the guy that was always prepared to help out with anybody, the boxing trainer and the fixer of all things bone and muscle. But to Ben and I, he was just Dad and Pop, and to my mum, husband. Before those two hands became the genius fixers that they were, Dad was a plumber. For years he dragged trenches by hand, stuck his hand down toilets, and precariously balanced on roofs of airport hangars in Dunlop bollies. No scaffolding then, just no fear and bloody good balance. If you ever saw Dad in his work gear, it was old, stained, and worn within an inch of its life, and his work boots used until the soles were hanging off. Dad was tough. And the day he walked in and threw a new pair of work boots onto the bench, it was met with great suspicion from Mum. suspicion from Mum. After him declaring his old boots were stuffed and he needed a new pair, he asked Mum to pull them off. The first one came off fine, the second one not so much. With some pulling and not a word from Dad, the boot came off, blood dripped on the floor, and then the explanation that the power saw had gone through his foot a few hours earlier. Mum was told that a hospital visit wasn't needed, and could she please get the tweezers and pick out the sop that was embedded in his foot. It was no small cut, and after diligently picking out the sock, a large amount of antiseptic, plenty of butterfly band-aids, and some bandages, Dad decided she'll be right and fronted up for work the next day. Luckily, Mum didn't have a weak stomach. Over the years, she regularly patched Dad up, and she did a brilliant job. After years in plumbing, Dad decided he was sick of cleaning up other people's shit. The trench digging was taking a toll on his body, and he was over it. For years, he had had a knack of being able to fix musculoskeletal issues for the family and just had this knowing for where things should be. After lots of discussions with Mum, the two of them then decided to do a massage course in Melbourne and train with Lester Cox, a local man who was also amazing with these type of issues. Hesitantly, and with a lot of trepidation, Dad made the call to ditch plumbing and see if he could make a go of the remedial sports therapy business. Just a side note, something that most of you don't know is that Mum also has exactly the same training as Dad did and quietly worked behind the scenes with some of the Essendon boys. When the two of them worked together, they were a formidable team, but it didn't happen often. Once stepping off the cliff, so to speak, it took a while for Dad to build the business, but the rest, they say, is history. Lots of you here today have graced the rooms of Dad for many years. Your names are repeated over and over in his appointment diaries. You weren't just his clients, you were his friends. And in some instances, friends that became family. He loved hearing your stories, he always kept your confidences, and most importantly, he loved stirring the hell out of you all. Now to dig into Dad's time in AFL. In the early 90s, my great aunt lived in Maribyrnong. Essendon Football Club were looking for housing for their new recruits, and a young guy by the name of Ryan O'Connor from Ulverston in Tasmania was housed with my aunt. He was having issues with his quad, and my auntie suggested that the next time Dad came to stay, Ryan asked Dad to look at it. He did, and with great success, the issue was sorted. Ryan went back to the club and said that his quad was fixed. There were some serious injuries in the club at the time, and in a fairly short period, there were quite a few blokes showing up on the doorstep whenever we were in Melbourne. One of those blokes was a guy by the name of Dean Wallace. What was to develop from this first pain-filled day on Dad's table was a relationship that took Dad to the next level of his professional career. From that relationship also developed a bond that was close and real. Dean became the son that Dad never had, and a mutual love and respect was born. I'd now like to read something Dean wrote for Dad on his 70th birthday and was read by Dean's beautiful wife Mandy at Dad's burial last week. John, Jock Rodwell, the gifted guru. Early one Sunday morning back in 1994, I ventured down to a house in Maribyrnong to see apparently this guru, who was going to fix my persisting leg injury that had kept me out of football for most of the 94 season. I was sceptical to say the least, having already been seen by just about every other supposed guru in the land. I was 2 days from going under the knife for a season-ending operation. What did I have to lose at this point? The introduction took place and I was asked what my problem was. My reply was, "If you're that good as your reputation, you tell me," was my blunt reply, much to Jock's surprise. I lay face down on the table. The consultation started. He worked from head to toe, then suddenly drove his thumb deep and directly into my calf. The exact point of my injury, in which I let out a four-letter word at the top of my voice, "Bingo, I've found your problem," was Jock's reply with a smirky grin plastered all over his face. For the next hour or so, he proceeded to torture the rest of my unturned and beaten up body, much to Jock's pleasure. I left that morning with a bounce in my step. There was no operation the following week, and I played the rest of the season. That Sunday morning, a guru was born in my eyes. For the next 7 years, Jock worked tirelessly on my body to give me an opportunity to perform in my profession, AFL football. An amazing friendship was formed, that so much he became part of my family. My wife and kids adore him as much as I do. He has been there for all of us. The weekends he would travel down the highway just to make sure my body was right, just to play a game of football. There were many weekends when half the Essendon Football Club were being treated by Jock pre-game out of the Wallace's garage, much to the disgust of the Essendon physios and doctors at the time. Jock got the job done where others had failed. The players and myself couldn't wait for the weekend to get the famous Jock tune-up pre-game, along with a few laughs, a couple of darts and a cold beer or two. The relationship didn't finish once I retired from playing. I accepted an assistant coaching role at St Kilda in 2001, who at the time had the worst injury rate in the AFL. I mentioned to Grant Thomas, head coach, about Jock the Guru Rodwell, and his reply was, just get him on board. And selfishly I did, not realising the commitment he would devote to the players and the time he would be away from his beautiful family. Jock turned the club around from having the worst injury rate in the competition to having their best players playing regular football week in, week out. For those who have been part of the Jock journey, you know what an amazingly gifted person he was. He has helped so many of us for such a long time. He has a gift never seen before and that we will never see again. Recently I visited Jock and Mirren in Bairnsdale. Jock still had his cheeky grin and shit-stirring attitude, which is his characteristic trademark I'll remember forever. We sat, talked, reminisced and laughed like the good old days. Don't worry, mate, I'll catch those bastards who pinched your smokes last night. I'll always be cheering home your lucky number 17 when it runs at the races, and I'll raise my glass every time I have a red, thinking of how lucky I was that I turned up to that appointment one Sunday morning 30 years ago when I was so close not to. Love you, mate. Rest in peace. Dean Wallace. The man behind the hands was a devoted grandfather and adored Ben from the minute he was born. At about 2 months, Ben developed horrendous colic. Whenever Dad came to visit, he would spend hours walking back and forth across the family room floor with Ben on his shoulder, Ben crying in pain for 4 or 5 hours straight every night. At this stage, Dad was in need of a full shoulder replacement, and no matter how much that shoulder hurt, Ben was never put down until he was settled. As he got older, Ben's favourite chocolates were always in the garage fridge. There was a bag of lollies from the canteen at the footy, and there was always hugs, staring, and lots of love from Pop whenever we visited. The other day, Ben asked me how we would go about life without Pop, and I'm still not sure. Sorry. But what I do know is that Dad's love for Ben was special. Right up until the very end, when there was little or no recognition of those around him, he still asked for his boy. And the fact they were some of his very last words. Mum and Dad were together for 57 years, and I remember years ago Mum telling me the first time she laid her eyes on Dad, she knew that he was the man she was going to marry. They married in Shepparton in 1969, and it was a marriage of devotion, patience, love, and lots of laughter. The two of them were the most content, sitting watching footy on a Saturday night, riding our horses in the bush on a Sunday, or pottering around in the garden. There was rarely an argument in our house, but by far the funniest of all was the day Mum totally cracked it at Dad for overbooking appointments, which was a pretty standard argument in our house. We were living at Swan Reach and we had a huge fish pond just out the back door. After Mum doing her knot over one of the football clubs turning up at 8 o'clock at night with not one but two carloads of players, Dad's appointment book was promptly hurled out of the back door, across the yard and into the fish pond, with Dad being told he could stick his bloody diary where the sun didn't shine. The two of them slowly watching it sink to the bottom. It took 4 hours with the hairdryer for Dad to dry out that diary, and it was almost impossible to read. I've never seen a better fight between the two of them. A few years after that, Mum's health began to decline, and for many years Dad became Mum's carer. After a 3-month stint in hospital in 2020, Mum was put in an MRI for us only to find she had dementia, which added a whole new dimension to the challenges we already faced with Mum's existing health issues. Dad once again stepped up to the job with few complaints and lots of love and care. For a large part of their marriage, I don't think it would have mattered if there was no one else on earth. He affectionately referred to her as his little Midge, and he was her jockey boy. They were perfectly content with each other for most of their lives. Houston, we have a problem. When Darryl Smith makes a comment like that, you listen. He wasn't wrong. In November 2022, it was obvious we were in serious trouble. Dad was diagnosed with what was described to me as one of the most aggressive, virulent forms of dementia. And in Dad's words, we were in more shit than a Werribee duck. It was quick, it was brutal, and it was heartbreaking to watch. The man I thought was immortal was slipping away from me one day at a time, and there was not a single thing I could do to stop it. How in the hell was I going to navigate this? I now had not one, but two parents living at home with dementia. At that point, we already had a carer in the house, but we were in serious need of more help in a big way. I wanted to make sure the last year of Dad's life was the best it could be, so I picked up the phone. Footy clubs are great at supporting their community, and a call to McMahon saw things very quickly swing into action. Mum and Dad were picked up for training each week, fed every Thursday night, and make sure it's beef, not a bloody chicken schnitzel. Meals were delivered, and footy games were attended each time Bairnsdale played at home. The Calverts, Stewie and Jackie, rose to the occasion, along with many others at the club, to support Dad and to make sure he got to spend his last season at Bairnsdale just as he would have wanted to. And I want to say a huge thank you to all of you for your love, patience and care of both Mum and Dad. On the home front, things were tricky. Fortunately, we had a great team of carers in the house, but one in particular was our lifeline, Margot Cuthbertson. This woman would have done anything for Mum and Dad and went above and beyond the responsibilities of a normal worker time and time again. You are truly amazing and the reason we are able to keep Mum and Dad at home for so long. To Ange and Michael, Luke and Emma and my family, these last 12 months have been absolutely shit and there's no way I would have made it through without you all, and I thank you. To Youngie and Turk, for being there for Dad in those last few hours, thank you. That took lots of guts. Last of all to Darryl Smith, you are my hero. Whenever I rang you, you picked up the phone. When things were bloody disastrous, you dealt with things in your usual cool, calm and logical way. And when I made that final phone call to tell you we were at the pointy end, you were there in what felt like minutes. The other day someone said to me, if Darryl was Batman, your dad was Robin. And that is possibly the best description I've ever heard of the two of you. I can't tell you how grateful I am to you for everything. Dad had the utmost respect for you and valued your friendship and would regularly tell anyone what a good bloke Smithy was. In Dad's words, your blood was worth what bottling. Like Dad, you are one in a million. Dad's life was doing things by his rules, telling it exactly how he saw it, a dose of love, tough love when required, and knowing he always had my back. I was truly blessed to have this man as my father. We had a relationship of love and dedication to each other, and I'll miss him terribly. I'll miss his dry humour, always wondering what happened to my knife and fork when it was nicked off the table, and regular drownings with a hose. We talked about a lot of things in the last 12 months, but the two things that stuck with me were great advice. One, you will never win an argument with someone who always thinks they're right. And two, never betray a confidant. Take those secrets to the grave. The night before Dad died, I sat beside him and told him how grateful I was for all that he had done for me. The love, care and generosity of spirit that he had always shown. I also reminded him that he had always been on my team as one of my biggest supporters and that now, just because he had decided it was time to leave me, he was still required to be on my team, barracking from heaven. The next time you head to the footy, step into the boxing ring or face your next biggest challenge, ask him for help, know that he's watching, quietly supporting you in the background, just as he always has, with a bag of lollies, Mentos, and a coffee and a cigarette in hand. I love you, Dad.
Thanks, Sharon. I'm sure that everyone here would agree that the tributes that have been shared today and Laurel's singing have been really beautiful. Certainly testament to how loved and respected Jock was. Now, I know everyone here this afternoon has their own special memories and stories, and a lovely way to continue celebrating Jock's life is to join his family directly behind you at the club rooms. There's been some refreshments. I'm sure there's a cup of tea, maybe something a bit stronger and colder on offer. And I know that Sharon and the rest of Jock's family warmly invite you to join them when we do conclude here today, as I said, to continue celebrating Jock's life. Also, to those watching us via live stream, when we do conclude today, if you just keep watching, there will be a video presentation of Jock's life that will follow the live stream, and those of you who are here in person, you'll be able to see that on some telly screens over in the club room, so it'll be playing while you're mingling, and just a lovely way to share some memories through some stories, through some photos. Well, it's clear that Jock is going to be remembered for so many reasons. He was someone you could rely on. He was a clever man, a great club man, a supportive and encouraging father and grandfather, and he was a cherished and respected friend. Kindness, resilience, humour, generosity and dedication are all qualities that have been a common theme throughout today's tributes, and they are qualities that I'm sure will be among memories and stories shared this afternoon while you honour Jock's memory. Jock lived his life never wanting or needing a big fuss made of him. However, this afternoon has certainly been a chance for you all to remember him fondly and most proudly, and I'm sure if he could, he would thank you all, particularly the front row here, for being such an important part of his life. I'd like to finish with a short, light-hearted verse, one that I feel certain Jock would have loved. Life should not be a journey to the grave with the intention of arriving safely in a well-preserved body, but rather to skid in sideways with a ciggy in one hand, a glass of red in the other, thoroughly used up, totally worn out, loudly proclaiming, "Holy shit, what a ride." That concludes this more formal part of today's service. For Jock, for those of you who are here from the Bairnsdale Football Netball, the Football Netball Club, if you could make your way to my right, to your left, where Craig is waving now, we are going to conclude with Sharon and Ben and then Jock's family, who are going to walk through the Guard of Honour and make their way over to the club rooms, and they're going to carry this beautiful photo of Jock in his memory. So we are now going to finish with one of Jock's absolute favourite songs in the whole wide world, "We Will Rock You," and it's going to be played nice and loud. Thanks, Dave.
We will rock you. Sing it! ba 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 ba
sunshine since I don't know when. I'm stuck in Folsom prison and time keeps dragging on, but that train keeps rolling on down to San Antone. When I was just a baby, my mama told me, son, always be a good boy, don't ever play with guns. But I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die. When I hear that whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry. Bet there's rich folks eating in a fancy dining car. They're probably drinking coffee and smoking big cigars. Well, I know I had it coming. I know I can't be free. But those people keep a moving, and that's what tortures me. Railroad train was mine, I bet I'd move it on a little farther down the line, far from Folsom Prison, that's where I want to stay. And I'd let that lonesome whistle blow my blues.